A very good morning and welcome if you've just joined us. I'm still in studio, joined by political analyst Jamie Mightie and Chris Thurman, Wits Associate Professor in the School of Literature, Language and Media. And we're speaking about the royal visit, what it means to South Africa and its people. Before we went to the ad break, we were discussing, you know, the arrival of other royal families from the African continent and that the kind of welcome that they receive when they come to South Africa and how it differs from the British royal family.
We've definitely shown a bit of a hypocrisy in how we view our own African cultures and our own traditions vis-a-vis this global institution called the British monarchy. I think we haven't afforded the respect that we are affording to Prince Harry, that we are to other African royal families. And I do think that the Biko inferiority complex point is relevant because we don't view our own institutions as being equivalent to those of a global nature. It extends to artists, it extends to our own work. But I do also want to say that I do think we need to have a broader conversation as Africans in general about the role of monarchies, because in as much as they are custodians of culture and tradition, at the same time, these are unelected people, you know, who get so much state support. I think one of the kingdoms receives over 50 million from the state fiscus. And I sometimes wonder whether or not that is something of value to us when we are all equal intrinsically at the point of birth. Why must one family get a cash injection of 50 million when your family doesn't get a cash injection of 50 million? You know, it's the lottery of birth. We have to reflect on it. However, I do appreciate that many people want to preserve their cultures and traditions as they are, and they want to afford those royal families the respect they deserve. But I do think that we also need to think about it and reflect whatever position we end up on.
And I mean, earlier on, we were just speaking about some of the causes that they're going to be here for. And we spoke about Meghan Merkel and the woman empowerment cause, her meeting with the various communities in the city of Cape Town. And I think she's teaching a self-defense class today as well. I mean, their visit comes off the back of weeks of protests against gender-based violence, especially in Cape Town with the death of Uyinene Mrwetyana, the gang violence that we've been seeing in the Cape Flats as well. Do you think their visit will really bring any relief to the people of Cape Town?
Well, I guess it depends on whether one thinks that distraction is a form of relief, or if somehow the kind of symbolism that attaches to a royal couple, you know, gives you, as an individual who comes across them, some form of affirmation or empowerment. I think that when these kinds of tours are planned, obviously they happen months in advance, but it does, I suppose, despite the best will in the world from somebody like Meghan wanting to show, you know, let's demonstrate that women can, you know, find ways of kind of fighting back against the patriarchy, which is what the symbolism of the self-defense classes is. It's much more complicated in South Africa. So a lot of, I think, feminist kind of gender-based violence activists would say, why is it that we place emphasis on women's defense of themselves as opposed to, you know, kind of tackling the violent patriarchy that forces women to have to defend themselves? So on the one hand, there's tremendous value in that symbolism. On the other hand, it's always more complicated than you know, even a well-meaning individual can address. So they land in South Africa and in Cape Town at a time when so much more has been happening. One almost feels slightly sorry for them as two individuals when there is such a complicated kind of social, political, economic environment around them that doesn't really need them to intervene or interfere. and I think that perhaps speaks to the point that Jamie's making, that you know, from a South African or, let's say, African point of view, we don't really need these people to bring their goodwill to us. The question is, does it give us the opportunity to hopefully be critical, as one would hope that they are critical of the establishment that they're part of, so that when, for example, there's a story about Thomas Cook and, you know, travellers stranded overseas, we are concerned for British travellers who are stuck in their exotic travel locations. You know, the reason that we have that kind of skewed media bias or narrative, I'm not blaming Newsroom Africa, it's true of all of us, we expect to hear that kind of thing, is because for decades and centuries we've been interested in the prominence of the British monarchs as a kind of symbol. Again, I'm overusing that word, but I think it's a chance for us to reflect on the danger of the kind of glamour that attaches to the monarchy. But I also think there's a small inkling of a possibility that figures like Meghan and Harry might recognize that and one hopes might seek to undo some of it. Mm. But maybe that's just me trying to be too optimistic about this. Yeah. I think that the greater value for us as South Africans is the inward turn, the reflective opportunities this gives us to think about our position, the way we see ourselves with respect to, for example, the global north, but also the way we might critique some of our own traditional structures and how we weigh up that difference between heritage, symbolism, kind of cultural value, and maybe more material concerns, which might seem to butt up against those.
Mm. Okay, well, we're going to wrap up this conversation. And for those viewers who are just tuning in now, Jamie, you had quite strong opinions about the royal visit. Just wrap up your views on their visit to South Africa and what it really means to us as South Africans. What should we be looking out for during this time?
Well, for me, this visit is more of the same in terms of the British institution of the monarchy. There is no significance that it has unless it comes to Africa to apologize for the atrocities, to bring back the jewels that continue to exist within the empire. And also, just speaking to the causes that they're representing, unless they brought a bag of money to give gender-based violent activists to actually deal with the issues, I really couldn't care less that they are here and that they are also supporting our issues. Because they have a bag of money that they took from Africa, and unless they're bringing that bag of money back to help us deal with our issues, be it education, be it gender-based violence, we don't need a karate class from Meghan. We really need that British money that came from Africa. That's where I stand on it. It's one of the few issues where I'm very clear on, because we know the role that the British family played in colonization of Africa. We're still suffering from the consequences of that. We're underdeveloped as a consequence. Nobody gets a free pass. No matter how handsome and beautiful you are, you got to account. Mm.
And you, Chris, your closing comments as the royal family touches down in South Africa today?
Yeah, it's a long hashtag, but come back with a bag of money has a certain appeal to it. Mm. So maybe one could say, you know, welcome, have a nice time. We'd like you to come back with a bag of money.
Hashtag that.
All right, well, thank you so much.
Or more money than you're bringing this time. Anyway.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that. That is Chris Thurman, Wits Associate Professor in the School of Literature, Language and Media, as well as Jamie Mighty, our resident political analyst. Thank you so much for joining us. Well, let's take a look at other news.